Hi, my name is Chief Billy Major. I'm the chief of the Buffalo Niagara International Airport Fire Department. I want to welcome you here today. We're going to take a look at the station, or as we lovingly call it, the firehouse. So come on in. Hey, so you're in our hallway, and this is where we start all of our tours. And today, we're going to talk about this part of the wall. This is our heritage wall of our history. Our fire department started in 1981. Prior to that, Buffalo Fire was here. But in 1981, the fire department started. And we're still here today. Not many people know that there's a Buffalo Airport Fire Department. But we're an important part of the safety for the airlines and for you here at the Buffalo Airport. In this cabinet, we have different badges from when we first started. Some of our hats, some of our gears. We used to wear the silvers. We don't wear silvers anymore. This is our logbook. We write everything down. We keep track of everything. This is the logbook from the very first day of July 1st, 1981, when we first started. And so from now, we're going to see the rest of the house and enjoy the tour. Hey, so every house has a kitchen, right? Or a dining room table where you eat. This is our dining room table here. And these are some of the guys that are working here for the fire department. We have 36 firefighters on staff. There's 9 on duty. So quick visit. We got Paul. We got Tim, we got Andy, Billy, Brian, Mike, and the boss, Scott. Every crew has a boss on shift, and Scott's the boss today. And this table that we have down here that you're going to see is a table of love from the fire department. We sit at this table for all of our meals. We're one big family, just like you are. And this table was made with love and hard work of the firefighters to put this table together and made it happen. So. Just a quick snapshot of just where we eat our meals and go to every day. So this is our kitchen, and this is where we get a lot of oohs and ahs when you come into our kitchen. Remember, we're here 24/7, so every meal, we're here. Holidays, Christmas, Thanksgiving, we're here. And the guys and girls that work here, you know, like to cook and they have good meals. So we have a fantastic kitchen here with a commercial grade stove, fire protection for it, our two refrigerators, the freezers, and a lot of laughs and a lot of conversations take place in this room, just like everybody else's kitchen at home. Hi, so now we're in our watch room or our communication center. Our communication center is manned 24/7. There's always somebody in here to answer the phone, answer the radios. Any emergency call comes through here. And Faye Maxwell, our dispatcher that's on today, is one of the original firefighters from 1981, still on duty, still working for us, and has been a great asset. You'll see we have multiple computer screens that Faye has to master and see. We also have our communications on those screens. We also have our fire alarms. We monitor the fire alarms for the entire Buffalo Niagara Airport and Niagara Falls Airport. And up top, we have a screen that shows different parts of the airport. So if we get a call, Faye is able to zoom in on that call and give us a heads up of what's going on there prior to us getting there. And there are hundreds of cameras throughout the airport. Hey, so this is our truck room. This is the best room in the house. We have all kinds of trucks in here. On the one side of the house, you're going to see some structural trucks. On the other side of the house, you're going to see the crash trucks or our airport trucks. So we respond on these calls. This is the way that we're going to go out, and the guys are going to pull out. Segments we want to do today is talk about kitchen safety, and we are blessed to have firefighter Andy LaForce here to give us a few tips on kitchen safety. Andy?
So just real quick, a couple things you could use at home if you ever have a fire on the stove. A couple good idea techniques is you can smother the fire by putting a lid on top of it, killing the heat, the pot itself. And another option too is we can always use baking soda, very good on the same thing. Just sprinkle it right over top of the fire should put it out. Good thing to keep in mind though for safety is a lot of people like to use oil or grease when they're cooking in the stove. If you ever have a fire involving oil or grease, you never want to throw water on that. Water reacts very violently to fires like that. So what we want to do is a good option to have at home. They actually come in smaller cylinders. Use a Class B extinguisher. Class B is used for any type of liquid fires. You can put that out using the pass system. You want to PASS stands for P-A-S-S. You want to pull the pin out, aim it, squeeze, and sweep on the fire. And just a few more tips for your family at home that have little ones. Always try to keep your kids at least 3 to 5 feet away from the stove area. Obviously, you don't want to come anywhere near fire. Keeping objects, keeping it clutter-free. We don't want them getting knocked over, kids running over, touching the handles. Obviously, their safety is paramount. Also, big thing too is Thanksgiving, holiday ones, a lot of fires there. A lot of fires happen because the stove is unattended. If you're cooking, please stay home, be in the kitchen, keep an eye on it, be in the house. So just don't leave, run to the store and come back. So a lot of fires happen, people lose their houses and safety like that. So please, if you're gonna cook, be around the kitchen.
Hi, I'm Firefighter Mike Garuba.
This is Firefighter Brian Beal.
Today we're going to talk about donning our PPE and SCBA. This is actually one of our skills in our Fire Academy we go through. We go through Structural Fire Academy and AR Fire Academy. This is one of our New York State skills. It's donning everything within 2 minutes. A couple key components here are obviously our helmet, our face piece, which hooks up to our SCBA itself. We have some gloves here. Nomex hood, which goes underneath your jacket, protects your ears and head. Your boots, your bunker pants, and finally your bunker coat. So like I said, New York State, to pass these skills says we have to don everything in less than 2 minutes. So we try to stay proficient with this just so we can get our gear on quick to get out of the house. When we are actually donning our SCBA, it has to be done not only fast, but correctly. So Firefighter Beal is gonna demonstrate how we actually don our gear correctly and fast. Right, Firefighter Beal?
Sure.
Go. So now he's pulling off his bunker pants. He'll put his suspenders up over his shoulder. Bunker coat on. Now he turns his SCBA on before it's on his back. That beeping you hear, that's part of his pass alarm system. We'll talk about that in a second also. The straps go on just like a book bag. Face piece on. Hood up over his head to protect his head and his ears. Helmet on, chin strap tight. Gloves on air, and buckled up. You got your Firefighter Beal. And we're good to go. We're good to go safely. So now, as you can see, it's kind of, when we're in a structure, we have to talk to one another. Sometimes we're not right next to each other. So if he's trying to talk to me, go ahead, Brian. It's a little bit muffled, and it can be a little bit overwhelming for somebody that is obviously in some sort of situation they don't want to be in. If they hear the firefighters coming through talking to one another, don't be afraid. So it's common for us to talk to one another. There'll be tools, it'll be a little bit loud, we'll be crawling along because we can't really see. Also, we have a pass alarm. If he stands here for 20 seconds and doesn't move, it's going to start making a chirping noise. So it's been 20 seconds. And then 7 seconds after that, it'll make this noise. So that's the noise that our SCBA makes. If a firefighter happens to go down and is either trapped or lost, they can actually manually set this pass alarm off. We go home and try to find them. Great job, Firefighter Beal. All right, we're back with Firefighter Beal after successfully donning our SCBA and PPE. Chief, what time did he have?
A minute and 20 seconds.
All right, minute 20 seconds, that's very good. Like I said, New York State says we have to do it within 2 minutes. Minute 20 seconds is great. Well done, Firefighter Beal.
Thanks, Mike.
So now we're gonna talk about some of the equipment we carry just on an everyday basis. If we had some sort of alarm at the terminal, this would be some sort of high-rise situation. We have our hose pack here, flathead axe, the tool, maybe sometimes a water can. With the gear itself, the SCBA, our helmet, gloves, the hose pack and the axe, we're well over 100 pounds of just carrying gear. And we gotta remember, we're going up and downstairs. Firefighters become fatigued. very rapidly, especially within the conditions. So if the conditions are poor, high heat, and even the heat outside can take a toll on a firefighter. Become dehydrated very quickly. It's very important for us to stay hydrated. You never know when the next call is going to happen.
Hey, it's Chief Major here. I'm with a couple of our firefighters, and we're just going to talk about their experiences as firefighters in the airport ARF world. I've got Firefighter Damien, I've got Assistant Chief Jessica, and Firefighter Tim. Jessica, what brought you into the fire service?
Family, actually. Growing up, my grandfather was a Buffalo fireman. My dad was an assistant chief at our volunteer department. Uncles, basically family. So it's all I kind of knew growing up. It became the normal. So I joined an Explorer program and eventually became a firefighter, a volunteer firefighter. And eventually that became my career. It's wonderful being able to do something you love for a career. And family is the reason why.
One of the things that we get to do here with this great firehouse and this great staff that I have is to give lots of tours. And lots of times we have younger kids that come in for the tours and they ask us all kinds of questions. Timmy, one of the questions that they ask is, what kind of training do we do here on a daily basis?
And so here at the airport, we have the pleasure of, we take on an additional role here. We deal with crash trucks and we deal with airplanes. That's our primary focus. We do also do our standard firefighting with a standard fire engine. But we go out, we have a plane that was donated to us. We do a lot of training on that. We'll ladder the plane, we'll go in and remove victims. We are practicing constantly maneuvering these crash trucks, getting used to laying down a foam blanket, which is what we'd use on a fuel fire here at the airport. So a lot of different hats that we wear. We do EMS also at the terminal, but our primary goal here is airport firefighting, and this is where we use our crash trucks.
Damien, some of the specialty stuff that we do besides EMS that Timmy talked about and all the aircraft stuff is hazmat and confined space. Now, our hazmat isn't a typical hazmat. We do the operation stuff, but what do we do with the confined space? What kind of things do we do with our, when we talk about confined space?
Well, we have a large facility here at the airport, and we have a bunch of different confined spaces where we have workers that go into tight spaces that may not be the best environment for them. So we do have to monitor the area to make sure it's safe for them to go in. So we do take on that role here at the airport to make sure that all the workers are safe no matter where they work here at the airport.
Jessica, what kind of work schedule do we work here at the airport, and how often are you here, and do you consider these guys to be your family?
Yeah, sure. So we don't work the normal Monday through Friday, 9 to 5. The schedule here consists of two 10-hour days followed by two 14-hour overnights, and that's split into four platoons. So once you do your 2 days, your two overnights, you have 4 days off, which is a great schedule for the family. And speaking of family, these guys become family. We spend so much time together. We spend holidays together. We have meals together. We trust basically each other with our lives. We become very tight, and even outside of work, our families hang out together and we do things. So the fire service is a great place for that.
So just a quick bit to meet the firefighters that we have here, and we're going to move on.
Airport Fire Department, one of the four assistant chiefs. I'm going to talk to you a little bit about our aircraft fire rescue vehicle. This is our newest one. This is our F4. This will be our primary mutual aid truck. Some of the differences this has compared to a regular structural firefighting piece. Obviously, you'll see the large tires on it. These trucks are four-wheel drive or six-wheel drive, depending on the vehicle you're looking at. It's carrying 3,000 gallons of water and 420 gallons of foam concentrate. So our job is to respond out to crash fires. If an aircraft comes down, we're to put out 90% of the fire in 90 seconds, and create rescue paths for the people to exit the plane in an emergency. Some of the equipment we have on here, a standard fire engine does have. We do have hand lines on the truck. We carry supply hoses on the truck. Some of them have ladders on them. But we do also have some specialized equipment as well. Aircraft today have a lot of specialty metals that are water reactive on board. So we have extinguishers to handle that. They obviously have a lot of computer equipment. Some of our trucks actually carry clean agent firefighting extinguishers that won't destroy computer equipment if we have to use it on them. We have some different axes we use for crash fire rescue. They have a different head. It's designed to cut through the metal as you're chopping with it, as opposed to just chopping wood and structural members like that. We have some large rotary saws. If we were to have to make entry into the plane, we can cut through windows, we can cut through the side of the aircraft. It's a little bit larger than your normal ventilation saw you would see in the fire service. A couple more things about our crash fire rescue trucks. They have the ability to flow large amounts of water through master stream devices. This truck, F4, has two of them, a roof-mounted turret and a bumper-mounted turret. One turret can be flowing 1,000 gallons of water or 1,250 gallons a minute, and the other one will flow at 750 gallons a minute. Both of them can't do the 1,250 gallon max at the same time because we have to conserve our water and agent because we have a long time to resupply. One of the other things you'll see on top of the truck is a little white camera looking thing up there. It says FLIR on the side. That's forward looking infrared radar. That's so we can see heat signatures and stuff if we're pulling up to an aircraft. Can be used to check levels of fluid in our fuel farm tanks. If we had an emergency over there without getting up near the tanks where the sight gauges were, we can actually see the levels in the tank using something like that. On our truck over here, F6, which is our older truck, a couple differences, still the 3,000 gallons of water, still the six-wheel drive. This has a piercing nozzle, a high-reach extendable turret on top of the truck. We can actually pierce the aircraft if we have to, generally in a cargo situation, to disperse agent into the truck. This truck also has a bumper turret, a little bit smaller than the one on F4. And down here, it also has a reel for Halon, that clean agent I mentioned talking about on F4 that we can use in computer control rooms and stuff like that.
So there's a couple of different things that are unique about our job at the airport as firefighters here. One is these much bigger vehicles that we have. As you notice right now, I'm actually in the middle of the vehicle, and it's a little bit different trying to adjust to turning in the middle, as well as the tires are behind you, and the fact that the vehicle is so much bigger than just, say, a normal car that you would drive or truck on the highway. So you have to adjust for that and making room and making sure that you're not going to hit anything. Another thing that is a little more specialized with us is the fact that we deal with jet fuel a lot. With the bigger planes that are out there, they require jet fuel. And it's a little more different properties than, say, regular gasoline. And what most people don't know is that gasoline can actually be more dangerous than jet fuel because it will ignite at much lower temperatures than jet fuel will. Also, another thing is we actually have on our vehicles here, we have an infrared system where we can detect heat. If the engines are really hot or if the brakes are really hot, we can look at that and see if there's a problem and needs to be addressed. So on these vehicles, we actually have multiple ways of putting out fires. Several different ways depending upon the fire, specialized ways of putting out those fires.
Hi.
I am Firefighter Bill Locker. I'm with the Airport Fire Department, and today we're going to do a demonstration of how we would do a response drill to a airplane. Dispatch F4, we're good to go.
So that sound you hear is the crash phone ringing from the tower alerting us that we have an aircraft emergency. As you see, the doors go up in 15 seconds, and the guys keep coming out.
1-4, hold short.
Buffalo Tower, F4.
F4, Buffalo Tower.
four is on the ARF access road, would like to enter runway 1432, crossing runway 23, exiting at Delta 3 to the Old North South.
Out of four, company, Roger. Proceed on runway 14, cross runway 23 at 14.
Buffalo Tower F4 is proceeding on to runway 14, crossing runway 23 to Delta 3.
Okay, so right now the trucks are simulating that we have an actual aircraft emergency and there is a fire on the plane. So our trucks have pre-designated assignments for rescue pass, firefighting, and then backup firefighting. Our engine is also responding. They'll do EMS as needed or direct people away from the aircraft if they can. So the first truck responding, F5, our red truck, he's cutting the rescue path. F6 is going to go and hit the fire from the nose, and he can work either side of the aircraft. And then F4 is going to take the left side of the aircraft. With this type of aircraft and the number of passengers this could carry, obviously our crash test would be doing the job they just did, knocking down the fire, protecting the egress pass for the passengers on the plane. Our engine would set up and start pulling people from the aircraft if need be, and starting a triage area for walking wounded. Myself, with our command vehicle, I would set up command. Our mutual aid resources would have already been contacted, would now be on their way. We have a staging area over on the one roadway where all units come in. Officials from the county and local volunteer departments and City of Buffalo will all meet there, and we'll start bringing in the resources we need at that time. Maybe additional fire trucks, ladder trucks. We may be laying supply lines out here so we don't have to take our trucks back and supply water. We'll just lay a supply line right to them out here, and we'll just keep working. Ambulances will then start coming out and removing the worst wounded at that time, and then we'll work back to what we call our green or our walking wounded. And that's generally how a crash would go for a response from us.
Hey, so this wraps up our tour of the Buffalo Niagara National Airport Fire Department. We're very happy that you came out to spend some time with us. But it's time for us to go to work, and that's what we're gonna do. So you all have a great day and stay safe.